Hey YouTube, this is Leo with Remodeling Calculator, and in this video I'll show you how to use our heating costs calculator to estimate your heating fuel costs for the season, as well as your energy savings from upgrading your equipment to a higher efficiency or to a different fuel source or a different type of equipment, for example from a furnace to a boiler or to a ductless mini split, or by adding insulation to your house. And you can do this in any combination you wish. I actually have questions for you. Basically, I want to know how much did you spend last year to heat your house. You can go by months or for the whole season. So let me know in the comment section below what kind of heating system you have and what you use for heating, either natural gas, oil, propane, or maybe electricity, and what kind system you have, what efficiency, how big is your house, and what state you live in. It's very interesting to me for data processing. And just as a quick sidetrack, this is a Emporia monitoring system that I use to monitor my heat pumps. I use air source heat pumps or mini splits, and right now it's using 1000 watts to heat a 600 square foot space. So it's not very cold right now, it's about 30 degrees Fahrenheit, but 1000 watts, just so you can picture it, it's a medium-sized space heater that you plug in your wall. Okay, that's how much it will use. 1000 watts to 50, they're maxed out at 1500 watts. I'm using 33% less energy to heat a 600 square foot space when that space heater can only do like 150 square feet and barely. All right, so let me know if you have any questions or comments. Put them in the section in the comment section below, and now let's take a look at the calculator. So our calculator, let me zoom in first so you can see better, because a lot of you will be watching this on a mobile device. So our calculator detects your approximate location, and so I'm in Massachusetts, and it correctly detects me as in being in Massachusetts. However, sometimes there is a false detection or not accurate detection, and so if that is the case for you, this state is not where you're actually located, you can just scroll down a little bit over here, and there is a states table, and you can just select your state, just click on it, and it will change the state. And also this table contains all the heating fuel costs in your area. Now, because states are huge, in some places different energy suppliers will have varying prices. These are state averages, and all this information is based on US Department of Energy, so big thanks to them. All right, so let's for example set our state as New York. All right, so we click on this and it changes to New York, right over here. Okay, and so the calculator is pre-populated with the energy costs in your state. Now, again, for example, New York City might be more expensive than Albany or vice versa. So you can adjust all these numbers right here. So this is a natural gas price, heating oil or fuel oil, propane, and electricity. Now, most of you will not heat with electricity because like baseboard heating is very expensive. However, there are the two kinds of electric fired heating systems that are supremely efficient, and those are included in here. Those are ductless heat pumps and geothermal heat pumps. Okay, so there's also a central heat pump, but it's not as efficient. Most of them will not heat below 32 degrees Fahrenheit, so at a water freezing level, or even slightly above it, they will stop using the heat pump and they'll switch to an alternative fuel, in most cases gas. So we didn't include those because their usability is limited. So anyway, how to use this calculator? Let me just zoom on a little bit. All right, so first put in your home size, and only include the heating space, heated space. So don't include your unheated garage. It doesn't make sense to include it because that's not living space, that's not heated space. Okay, then if your actual energy cost is different, for example, if you're paying, let's say, $2.50 per therm for natural gas, just change this price, and the oil price and the propane price are approximate average based on US Department of Energy. And for most people, propane is not necessary because it's mostly for like people in remote areas. And propane is less efficient than oil and usually more expensive to run. Anyway, and electricity is usually accurate, but again, depending on the city where you live or your electric company, they may have different rates. So you should basically look at your electric bill and take the total consumption, total kilowatt hours. So for example, you're using 500 kilowatt hours per month, and divide your total bill by the number of kilowatts, and you'll get your price in cents per kilowatt hour. So in New York, the average price is about 20 cents. All right. So next, select your heating equipment. A lot of you will have a furnace. A lot of you will have a boiler. Most of you will not have a ductless heat pump or geothermal or electric baseboard heaters. Okay. And then you can actually calculate for one and then calculate for the other, and as well as play with the efficiency. So we're calculating for a 2000 square foot home. Let's click calculate. So here are the results. It basically shows you fuel costs for each type of heating fuel. So as you can see, in our case, oil and natural gas are pretty on par with each other. However, in most places, natural gas does not cost $2.50. It's usually about $1.50 to $1.90 per therm. And also, here's a quick note. If your gas company is not charging you in therms, or for example, they're charging you in 100 cubic feet or 1,000 cubic feet, it's pretty straightforward. So 100 cubic feet is about the same as a therm. So you don't need to change anything. However, if they're charging you in 1,000 cubic feet, so if it says MFC on your bill, so and you have a price, for example, like $15 per MFC or per 1,000 cubic feet, just divide that by 10, and you will get your price per therm. Okay, so our calculator is using therms. It really doesn't matter. Different companies use different measurements or units. So we just chose to go with therms. But it doesn't really matter. If you get charged in thousands of cubic feet, just divide that price by 10 and put it here. Okay, so let's adjust this to 1.7, which is typical. And you can see basically your approximate cost of heating your home with each type of fuel. So usually natural gas will be the cheapest. However, in some states, it's more expensive than oil or propane, where there is limited supply of natural gas and there is no like pipelines, so it's hard to deliver it there. So in those cases, fuel oil or propane will be cheaper. And you can actually look at the table over here and find like, so over here in Georgia, or well, Hawaii is an outlier because everything is expensive in Hawaii, but in Georgia, so a therm of natural gas costs $3.14, which is about the same as a gallon of oil. Our gallon of oil has more, about 40% more heating content or heating BTUs than a therm of gas. And propane is even cheaper than the natural gas, all right? And also the electricity is fairly inexpensive there. However, in Idaho, natural gas is extremely cheap. And so is electricity. And this would be interesting. I'm actually going to run a calculation for Idaho. This is very interesting. I want to see very cheap gas versus very cheap electricity. Which one is the winner? Okay, so back to the calculator. This number here shows your total heating BTU consumption per season. So about 6 months, 3 months are very high consumption, and 3 months relatively low consumption. And so there is a formula that we use to calculate your total consumption. And we divide this by the number of BTUs in each unit of heating fuel. So, for example, there is about 100,000 BTUs in one therm of natural gas. And so that's why you can see this number. If we divide 122.5 million by 1,000, we get 1,225 therms. Okay, there is 140,000 heating BTUs in a gallon of oil, and about 80-something thousand in a gallon of propane. And so electricity, it's about 4,000 BTUs per kilowatt hour, but that doesn't really matter. So this shows your total BTU consumption in your home, and you can actually change this. So for example, if your home is well insulated, your BTU consumption is lower, okay, and so is your consumption of heating fuel as well as your cost. Okay, so next step, you can see if you want to upgrade this to a more efficient system. So most hot water boilers, and I want to make a note that boilers here assume that you have forced hot water, because most new installations do not go with steam, unless you have steam and you prefer not to run radiators. So in most, we consider that your system is using a warm air radiator, so forced hot water and not steam, because steam is also less efficient. Anyway, so if you go with a 90 to 95% efficiency, that is your condensing boiler, and those run only on gas, they do not run on oil. So, for example, this here, the oil price, it's of no value to you because condensing boiler will not run on oil. It only runs on natural gas. Maybe in some cases it could be converted to propane, but definitely not oil. Okay. And the electrical cost here is given for reference purposes, and it's given for baseboard space heaters. Okay, it's not given for those high efficiency heating systems such as ductless heat pump or geothermal. So those you have to calculate separate. Okay, so if you have a very old boiler, like for example, you have an old coal-fired boiler, which was converted to oil, or in some cases it could be converted to gas, but that's rare. So you can calculate here, and you would see that this is your price for the season. This is how many gallons of oil you would go through during the season, the heating season. All right. So in this calculator, you can see how much you would save by upgrading to a more efficient equipment. So for example, from using a standard efficiency gas boiler, you would spend $1,800. And if you upgrade that to a condensing boiler, you would save about $200 per year in heating costs. And so over 5 years, that's about $2,000. Over a 5 year period, that's $1,000. And I want to actually make a separate video about, is it worth it to even upgrade to a condensing boiler? Because in my opinion, in many cases, it's not worth it. So that's a whole separate video and a whole separate subject, which I will actually talk about later. But let's now talk about furnaces. So furnaces, you can see if we switch from boiler, which has about the same efficiency as a standard efficiency furnace. So here you use 108 million BTUs approximately. And if you switch to furnace, you'll use a lot more than that. So you use 20 more million BTUs. And the reason for that is not just the 2% efficiency. It's actually the loss in the ducts, which can go as high as 40%, according to Department of Energy. But in most cases, it's about 15 to 25%. So I would say about 20% average if you have uninsulated. And you can see we actually have a duct insulation type. So if we add insulation, you're shaving off immediately about, so going from uninsulated ducts, you use 129 million BTUs, and going to 10R insulation, you shave off about 14 million BTUs, and in dollar terms, you save, let me see, so $2,200. Let's go here. So you save about $200 per year by upgrading to insulate the ducts. And also consider that if you have ducts, you also have central AC most likely. So you'll also be saving money during the summer on the electricity costs. We actually have an AC energy cost calculator. If you go over here and search here, right? So AC energy cost calculator. If you're on mobile, it's a little harder to find. So I'll just link it in the description for this video. Okay. And so let's play with the efficiency. You can see you immediately shave off another like 18 million BTUs. And this is primarily the 15% difference in what goes out the chimney. So the high efficiency furnaces, they can get as efficient as 98%. That means only 2% of heat that's burned inside the furnace is lost to the outside air, and the rest of it stays in the house. However, from that heat, you still lose in the ducts. There is a substantial amount of heat that's lost in the ducts, and there's very little you can do about it. Even if the ducts are insulated, it's metal, which is a thermal mass. It absorbs heat, and you push hot air through it, the ducts heat up, and some of that heat still stays in the duct. So as much as you insulate it, you cannot get away from that problem. Okay, and if you have a very old furnace, so for example, I have a 30-year-old furnace with uninsulated ducts, which is 150,000 BTUs, and I think I only get like 80,000 BTUs out of that furnace. So if we calculate that, we lose about, we gain another 40 plus million BTUs, and our price jumps significantly. So for me, upgrading the furnace would be a huge benefit, so like $800 per year saving just in energy costs. But I am converting everything to ductless heat pumps. My whole house is getting high efficiency ductless heat pumps. So this is coefficiency of performance. Most of you will have a standard coefficiency of performance, and that's how much heat is produced per kilowatt hour. All right, guys, so let's take a small detour and talk about ductless heat pumps or mini splits, because this topic is very near and dear to me, and I really, really think they're great heating and cooling systems. So let's first deep dive into COP. So basically, when we look at how much energy is produced from 1 kilowatt hour of electricity, so 1 kilowatt hour BTU, all right, so we get 3.4 thousand. Okay, all right, so now your standard efficiency ductless heat pump will produce 3.2 times this amount. Okay, so let's put 3.2. oops, come on. Okay, so let's copy this and let's go into a calculator. All right, so we multiply this by 3.2. so for a standard efficiency ductless heat pump or mini split, you'll get close to 11,000 BTUs for each kilowatt hour of electricity that you use, and compare that to 3.4 thousand BTUs for baseboard space heating. Okay, and so high efficiency 3.7, so we divide this by 3.2 and multiply, oops, multiply by 3.7, get 12,500 BTUs, 12,600 BTUs per 1 kilowatt. So that's like almost 4 times more heat produced from the same amount of energy if you get a high efficiency ductless heat pump. And so what's even better, unlike heating oil, unlike propane or natural gas, which you cannot produce on your premises, right, electricity can actually be produced. Now, solar is great. There are some issues with it, you know, like it's still a little bit expensive. And not every state offers good incentives, and not every state has good net metering program. So, and not every household is actually, not every house is good for solar, because let's say your house is shaded or your roof is facing east-west instead of south, then solar is not really for you. And even though you can get it, and companies like Tesla, they'll install solar even on the north-facing side of the roof as long as you pay them. They don't care. Solar is not for everybody, but it's awesome, and you can actually produce it on premise. So at your house, you can produce electricity. And let's say you have net metering with your electrical supplier. So you will, let's say you overproduce in the summer, then that energy is basically gets stored, or you get credit for it, and then you can use it in the winter to heat. And that's what I'm doing. I just had 15 kilowatts of solar installed on my roof, and while it's not enough to completely offset my total heating and cooling and other electricity consumption at my house, I will be able to offset about 75 to 80% of that usage with solar. So basically, I will only be paying for 20% of my energy usage. I will not really need any gas, just for a cooked up, for a range and for a gas dryer, but that's insignificant. That's like $30 a month. Whereas my heating bill went up, was in the $600 range, because my furnace is so inefficient. And then I just had an email from my gas company saying the price went up 20%. So that would be like $720 in 1 month. Okay, so here it was like $1,600 for a whole season. Now my price is about $1.90 now. And my warm air furnace is 64% efficient and uninsulated. So 5 months, about $600, or 6 months, about $500 a month. So that's about what I was actually using, and how much I was paying for gas. And now I am going to be paying, so let's even say it's standard efficiency, okay? So I would be paying like $1,600 per month or per season, per year, but we take about 80% of that off. So I would only be paying like, say, $300-$400 per year for all of my electricity. This includes heating and cooling. Well, okay, so my house is poorly insulated. Let's say average, because it's not that bad. Okay, so $1,800. I would be paying about $400 a year for electricity. The rest will be generated by solar. And so my solar system will just basically pay for itself. I calculated within like 4 or 5 years with all the tax credits and rebates. And this is because I'm getting ductless heat pumps and doing it for my entire home. And now I still have my furnace as a backup in case, like, you know, whatever. In case, let's say, power goes down, I cannot heat my house with ductless heat pumps. I have some lithium batteries. I plug them in, and for a couple of days, my furnace can run. Okay, I have a pretty good storage, about 20 kilowatt hours. So furnace takes what, half a kilowatt hour, when the blower motor runs, and so that's the only electricity it's using. So, and it runs about 20 minutes an hour, so like 0.3 kilo. I mean, my battery storage can last me like a week to run furnace in my fridges. All right. So anyway, I just want to show you. So this is a web app from Emporia Energy. This is my energy monitoring, system. And you can buy this on Amazon. It's actually amazing. I was looking into something like this for a few years, and the only thing I found that was nearly as close as it was a Sense, which I really, this is Sense. It's like $300, and it is based on so-called AI or artificial intelligence, whereas you only have like 4 sensors, okay, and it guesstimates or guesses how much electricity you use, which I think is kind of insane. All right, and if you look at Emporia, this system has, so this device here, it's a wireless monitoring system, and you can have up to 16 individual circuits monitored. Okay, so this is one of my circuits. This is my heat pump in my bedroom. Okay, so right now, current consumption, it's using 734 watts to heat the bedroom. Okay, that's like half of what your, you know, full-size space heater uses. And it produces about 4 times more heat. It's insane. And we can even look at the months, okay? So in the coldest month, which was, let's shift this over a little bit. And so this was February of 2021, okay? I think it was January, February, because like that's how my billing cycle is. So I used on this device 658 kilowatt hours, okay? So if we calculate 658, and this was for one space that's about 600 square feet. So this is not my entire house. So we multiply it by 0.22 cents. So this is about a third of my house, and it cost me $144 to heat it. And our electricity in Massachusetts is very expensive. Now, national average, if you look over here, national average electric cost is 14 cents, okay? So 658 times 14 cents. So a typical, you know, average American would spend $92 to heat this house. Mine was a lot more expensive at 140 something. I don't even remember anymore. So this system is amazingly efficient, okay? And I just can't say enough good things about it. They are kind of expensive to install for the whole house. But then if you get it with solar, like you, after 3-4 years, you'll basically have almost nearly free heating and free electricity. And depending on where you live, if you have good net metering. And so in Massachusetts, we're limited by our inverter size. I can only have a 10 kilowatt inverter, because after that, I lose basically 40% of my net metering credit on everything, not on just over 10 kilowatts, on everything that I produce, I lose 40%. So it doesn't even make sense unless I go like really big system, like 50 kilowatts. No residential people do that. Okay, so like big residential installations are like 20, 25 kilowatts. And even 15 is pretty big. You know, it used to be like people would get 5 kilowatt system, and that would offset their typical electric bill. But because my goal was to heat with heat pumps, I I got a big system. But yeah, this was my highest month, guys. Look, so this is February. This is, let's say, January, February. This is like December, January, November. So like 470 kilowatt hours, like 520, 658 over here. And like February, March, it was, I would guess it was like 400 something. 407, 518, 469. And so if you average this over 6 months, you get about, say, somewhere around 350 kilowatt hours per month. Okay. And so for the season, it's about $75 per month to heat that space. So multiply that by three, maybe four, because my house is bigger. But then, like, another beauty of ductless heat pumps is that you don't have to run the whole house. So like furnace and boilers are better, because you can actually zone your boiler, and you can have, like, you know, the living area, which you kind of dial down during the night because everybody's sleeping and just the bedrooms get warmed up. So you can zone the boiler, and boilers are, on my list, are the second best heating system. Okay, but the furnace, you can't really zone. Even if you have like diffusers, they don't really work properly, and they still leak. So and they're expensive to install, and basically you still you also lose like up to 40% in your duct. So like furnace is just like not my personal favorite heating system. I just don't like furnaces. But heat pumps, you can just like have your bedrooms heated at night. You can set the rest of the house for, like, you know, minimum heat, 50 degrees, just so that your pipes don't burst. I don't even run heating system. Like, when it's super cold, I may put it on a low heat. But generally, I don't heat the rest of my house, except for the bedrooms, at night. And so you can just, you know, let's say you have 3-4 bedrooms, okay? You heat 3-4 bedrooms. Now, my bedroom is huge. It's like 600 square feet. You can have, like, 7,000 BTU units with, like, I don't know, 12,000 BTU heating, and that's enough for like 200 square foot bedroom. So your electric consumption in the winter for heating with the heat pump would be not as crazy. Again, this system here, it's heating a 600 square foot space that's not well insulated. All right. And this is a 9,000 BTU unit. I will link it in the description below. I've made already a couple of videos about it, the heating of that space in the winter. But anyway, so I took a big detour into heat pumps, but let's, so again, we'll keep the insulation on average, and so it would cost you less in electricity with the heat pump than gas, okay, because gas has become expensive. Actually, in New York, I think I modified that, so this is New York price. Let's put it here, okay. So in New York, electricity would be like $400 less to run an average efficiency ductless heat pump system. And that's assuming you're heating the whole space. Now, when you shut off the zones in the middle of the night, and then during the day when you're not in the bedroom, you shut off your bedroom zones, you actually use even less than that. Okay, and if you go into very high efficiency, so now the very high efficiency, there is an issue with that, because those would be like single zones, and I don't think many people would want to have like 5-6 compressors sitting outside their house. Most people would want maximum 2, because let's say you have a 4-5 zone compressor and you have a big house, so like you have 10 zones, all right, 2 compressors with 10 zones. But most people would not want a single zone systems for every single room in their house. They would have like 6-7-10 compressors outside. That's insane. I mean, I have 4 single zones, and I decided like that's enough, and I put a 4 zone system, a big one. But the efficiency of that unit is lower, so that's about 3.2 COP, and that's what we get here. So about $400 difference in New York between the gas, which is the most efficient, normally, and the geothermal heat pump. Okay, now I think this is calculated for, let's say, let's go into furnace. Let's set it for standard efficiency. And then go into ductless heat pumps. Weird. So this electricity, I'm not sure what kind of settings it uses. So we got to go back into this and look into it. I think it's using the highest efficiency furnace, 98, with insulated ducts and well insulated. Okay, so 2088. So let's go into ductless. Okay, we gotta really look into this. Yeah, but anyway, so by the time you watch this video, we'll iron out these small glitches here. I'll see at what settings it's being calculated. Oh, I know, it's very easy. It's using this BTU count. All right, that's what it is. So it's using this BTU, how many BTUs it will take, how much gas it will take to produce this many BTUs, okay? But because you have a massive loss, so okay, we just gotta make adjustment for heat loss and whatnot in the ducts and in the chimney or whatever other exhaust method that you're using. So final item we have is geothermal, and this is even more efficient. So remember, heat pump was 3.2, so average geothermal system is 4.3 coefficients of performance, okay, which is like absolutely insane. So you save another like $600-$700 if you just went with the standard efficiency geothermal. And actually you can get a high efficiency geothermal, they're just more expensive, and your electric bill would be just ridiculously small, like $1,200 for the whole season. But there's a caveat, and the caveat is very, very high installation cost. Okay, so if we go into ductless and calculate high efficiency ductless system, you'd be looking at mid-range of 25,000, high end of 30,000. Okay, so geothermal is double the price, and the problem with geothermal is it still uses ducts, so you still have losses in the ducts, okay, because it's a central system. Another problem is that you need to drill or dig a big, like either drill a well or dig a big hole in your backyard to install all the loops for the heat exchanger, because geothermal uses the heat in the ground, but you need to be below the freeze zone. So usually it's like 6-8 feet deep in the ground if you're laying loops, and it is 200-300 feet deep wells if you're digging straight down. So there was actually a whole school district in Vermont that was getting new heating systems, and they did calculations, and they were basically down to air source heat pumps, which is mini splits, ductless, and geothermal. And geothermal is very efficient, but it is, you see, like geothermal actually needs to produce more BTUs compared to a ductless system, but because its efficiency is higher, it uses less electricity. So anyway, that school district in Vermont was choosing between geothermal for all their schools or heat pumps, and they went with heat pumps. And Vermont is very cold. You know, like, and air source heat pumps, they extract heat from the outside air. So when you have very cold air, there is less heat to extract. And I mean, like, it sounds stupid. Like, how can you extract heat from a very cold air? Like, let's say minus 10 Fahrenheit. Like, it's deep freeze. But the thing is that boiling temperature of R410A refrigerant is minus 50 degrees Fahrenheit. So there's about 40 degrees of heat to be extracted. Now, the colder it gets, the less efficient it gets. But same with geothermal. You lose efficiency as it gets colder. But you can still heat in very cold temperatures using air source heat pumps. And what they did is with the savings, with the huge savings in upfront costs, they just installed a bunch of solar panels on all their roofs. So they're getting their own electricity. They don't have to pay for electricity to run those heating systems. And they even saved some upfront money. Okay, so let's compare this geothermal heat pump. Okay, so we get $60,000. All right. And ductless heat pump, 30. So you have $30,000 to invest in solar. That will get you about 12 kilowatts of electricity. 12 kilowatts of solar panels. And if you go with Tesla, it's even more, but then Tesla is a joke as a solar installer. I'm going to make another video about Tesla, how they basically ding me around for a whole year and just to tell me a year later that they cannot install solar on my roof. That's a whole different conversation. But basically, like, with the savings compared to geothermal, you can install a 12 kilowatt solar system on your roof and just generate your own electricity and pay a lot less in energy costs going forward. So basically, this is the functionality of this calculator. And if you're thinking about upgrading, you can get a quote by just entering your zip code and answering a few questions. You get quotes from contractors in your area. But so this is the calculator and its functionality. And we basically explain here all the questions that you might have. However, if you have questions about this video, it's really long by now, and I've covered a lot of topics, so feel free to ask them in the comment section below. Now, please like this video if you enjoyed it. I hope you did. I hope that I wasn't too boring. Just to spice things up, let's look at Idaho, how much it costs to hit a $2,000 home in Idaho. So we guess $1,300 for the whole winter. couple of remarks. This calculator uses not only your location, but it also knows that Idaho is a cold state, so it requires more heating. So if we compare this to Massachusetts, same specs. So let's see, 136 million BTUs for the season. Let's go to Massachusetts, and we're going to be, I think, 20 millions lower. 12, 14 millions BTUs lower. And that's because Idaho is a colder state. I mean, Massachusetts is not warm in the winter, but... But in Idaho, it's very cheap to heat your house. And if we do a ductless heat pump, $1,000 per year. $1,077 per year. And guys, keep in mind, these prices are constantly updated. They're up to date. They might be like a month or two behind because Department of Energy doesn't always update their prices on time. Think about it. They have to collect this data from a country with 330 million people and a huge country. So this data is not always up to date. That's why we give you an option to change the prices. But otherwise, I think this is a very useful tool. It literally took me like 6 months to come up with all the algorithms that I'm using here and with all the functionality. So I hope you enjoyed it. Please click like for this video. Share it with your friends. If you have any questions, ask them in the comment section below. And subscribe to the channel. I will be making a lot more videos about the efficiency of heat pumps, how to install them. I already have some videos. I just need to upload them. Basically, I have tons of videos from multiple installs of mini splits, and just need to process them and upload them, and everything takes time. So hope you enjoyed it, and once again, I will put all the relevant links in the description for this video, link to this calculator as well as link to the air conditioner energy cost calculator and my other videos. So thanks for watching. I'll see you later.